Hey everyone, welcome. Thank you for joining us in the Saturday morning and making space for the meetup in your time and your calendar. Glad to have you all here. So this is, I think, we skipped the meetup in the previous month due to certain, you know, scheduling issues, but we are back this month, August, and glad to have you all here. So can we have a quick rounds of like intros, like are people here for the first time? Are there anyone here in the Zoom call who is joining the meetup for the first time? So just that we can say hi to them. Okay, I'll take that as a no. And so yeah, to start off the Bangalore Observability Meetup August edition, we have Sandeep from Grafana today with us, and he is one of the core maintainers of the logging platform created by Grafana, Loki. And today will be one of the first sessions he will be doing for us. The initial proposal that I had for him was that, hey, we need to do a Loki deep dive. But very correctly, he proposed that, hey, why don't we start with a smaller intro session first, and then slowly we grow the community into like a deep and deeper dive. And I'm pretty sure we will have multiple sessions with him going forward in the other editions of the meetup in this year. And yeah, glad to have you here, Sandeep. You can unmute yourself and maybe you can just give us a quick intro and then start off with your talk.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for joining. I am Sandeep Sukhani. I live in Pune and have been working at Grafana from last 2.5 years. I am a Loki maintainer and have been contributing to it since I joined Grafana. So yeah, without further ado, let's start with the talk. We'll do a intro session today, and then we'll follow up with a deep dive with, the intro would be more focused on what Loki is and how it solves the logging problem with different compared to other logging solutions. And then the deeper dive would be more on the internals, how to what are the best practices, and so on. So Loki is inspired from Prometheus, and we'll see why we say it's inspired by Prometheus in a bit. So I already introduced myself. You can reach out to me on Twitter and email for any help regarding Loki or any other help in general. So the agenda of the talk would be, first we'll start with understanding the Loki model and how it works. Then we look at some of the features and how do you troubleshoot an outage in Loki. And then we'll start to do a demo, like ingesting the logs and querying the logs out of it. And then we'll see how fast is really Loki and how do you install and run it. So before jumping into it, let's look at a bit of history first. It was started by Tom and David in 2018 at Grafana. Then with some stabilization and adding some features to it, we did 1.0 release in 2019. And since then, we have not slowed down. The team has grown, the contributors have grown, and we have added a lot of features. We did a 2.0 in 2020, and recently, in this month itself, we released version 2.3. So, as I said, the community has grown a lot, and we have seen a lot of love from the community members. We have more than 350 contributors. Like yesterday, I checked, it was close to 398 something. So we are close to touching 400 contributors, and we average about 100 PRs between the release. So there are so many things that gets added between the releases, and we have over 13,000 GitHub stars. So with a project that started as recently as 2018, 13,000 GitHub stars is a very impressive number. So let's start with the Loki model. So Loki takes a different approach compared to other logging solutions. Like most of the logging solutions would index all of the logs. Like it would the index would contain all the logs that you that your logging solution your application is logging, and because of that the index grows as close to the amount of logs that you have, sometimes even bigger than that. And this causes a lot of problem. Like imagine logging 10 TBs of data and your index growing as big as a couple of TBs. But with Loki, we just use attach labels to the streams. So the index is much, much smaller compared to the logs that you are ingesting. So here an example would be with 10 TBs of log, you might as well have just 200 MBs of index. So yeah, that's the Loki secret sauce. This is the comparison of an example log line when indexed with Loki compared to indexed with Elasticsearch. So Elastic would index the whole log line, like all the keywords from their logs. And instead of that, Loki would just store the timestamp and some of the metadata and some labels from your logs, so that you, it should be able to find out the right logs when you need them. So because we say it's inspired from Prometheus, let's look at an example from the Prometheus itself. So a sample in Prometheus would have a timestamp, a metric name, and some labels attached to it, and the value reported by our application. So here the timestamp is in Unix, is a Unix timestamp in microseconds precision. There's a metric name called Nginx CPU usage, and the labels are labels attached are from your application, like which application is reporting this metric, and some additional details like what's the IP of it, or maybe you would attach the name of the host where it's running if you are running multiple replicas of your application, and the final value that was reported by your app. Similarly, if you are scraping logs from the same application, ingesting logs from the same application, then the index would look similar. So here, instead of microsecond precision, we have nanosecond precision for the logs for the timestamp. And similarly, the labels are what app the logs are coming from and which instance from it, and the actual content of the log. So as you can see, the content of the log would be not indexed. The index would just contain the metadata and the timestamp of the log. So the logs coming from same application are called, we name it a stream. So all the logs from same application would be called a single stream. So here you can see there are two streams. The first one is app nginx and the instance is 1111. And the next one is app nginx and the instance is 2.2.2.2. So the logs from the same stream would be stored together so that the queries would run faster. We are not going to cover much about how Loki stores the data in this session. Let's move ahead and
can I ask a question, or should I wait for the end?
Yeah, it's okay to ask a question.
Thanks. So what happens when you search for the bits which are unindexed? Does Loki pick it up, or how does it go through it?
Yeah, we'll look at the Loki query model in next slides.
Cool, thanks.
Yeah.
Hey, thanks Satya for the question, but let's we have a dedicated Q&A session time after the talk, so let's just wait till that time and let's put all questions in the chat, and I'll ensure that Sandeep answers them one by one. Go ahead, Sandeep.
Yeah, thank you. So this is the power of Loki. Like, it reduces the logs to a minimal amount. Sorry, index to a minimal amount. And if you look at it, if you have 1 TB, like, it's just a model. We think that it's not like we propose that this would be the proportion of your logs and the index. So if you have 1 petabyte of bytes of log, you have 80 TBs of selectors, the time, and you reduce the time frame so that it searches 1 TB of logs, and with brute force it can go up to 20 Gbps and more than that. So we'll see in a bit how fast Loki actually is. So let's start with how it works. So this is the architecture of Loki, and you can see there's read path and write path. So let's go with write path first. So there are multiple logging clients, and there's also an API which you can use for pushing logs to Loki. So when the logs come in, they first hit the distributor, which is something which would do the replication of the logs. So there's a consistent hash ring running between distributor and ingesters, using which distributor would decide which ingester the logs belongs to, so that all the logs belonging to same ingester would go to that itself instead of distributing logs all across the ingesters. So after getting logs to the ingester, the ingester would store the logs in memory for a configured duration, typically for 1 hour. And after that, it would flush the logs into something called chunks and add the index entry for those chunks in the index store. So the storage, long-term storage, is divided into chunk store and index store. And we support a couple of different types of object stores like S3, GCP, MinIO, Azure, and there are different index stores supported like Bigtable, Cassandra, DynamoDB, and BoldDB for running it locally. On the read path, there's query front end, which is responsible for splitting your queries, doing some sharding work, caching the query results in the results cache, and splitting the queries and forwarding those queries to the querier. And the querier component here is responsible for doing the actual queries on the long-term storage and querying the logs from the ingester, which it still has in its memory. So querier would first go to the index store, find which chunks would have the required logs based on your query, and it would then download the chunks, unpack the logs from it, and send the results back to query frontend, which would then send the results back to the component that is querying the logs. So here you can see we support different types of caches. The first one is the results cache, which is used by query frontend for caching the results from a query. So when you do that same query again, or the query overlaps somewhat with the previous query, then it would just fetch the results from the results cache and send the remaining query to the querier for finding the logs for the remaining duration. And similarly, there's an index cache which is used by the querier for caching the index from the index store, and there's a chunk store which is used by the querier for caching the chunks from the long-term storage. Similarly, here you can see there's a ruler component which actually embeds a querier with it. The ruler component is responsible for supporting rules and recording rules and alerting in Loki. So you can configure ruler to record some metrics, build and record some metrics out of it, and maybe alert on it based on the LogQL queries in the ruler component. So there's a lot much to this architecture. So because this is an intersection, I won't cover much because it would be too much to cover in an intersection. In the deep dive section, we'll see, we'll have deeper dive into how each component works. Some of the components that are not shown here, like the console or the distributed hash ring. So let's move ahead. So consider Loki is a black box here. you can even run it as a single binary. So we'll see how you can run Loki in different modes. So to talk about how you can get logs into Loki, there's a client called Promptail built by us, which is similar to Prometheus. Like, it would do the service discovery of the of your apps which are logging, which are doing the logging, and you can run it with Kubernetes or as a single binary. So we'll see how to run Promptail in a bit. So the Promptail would scrape the logs from your applications and it would send it to Loki. And there are different ways you can get the logs out of Loki. Like, you can use Grafana, you can hit the REST API, or there's a LogCLI client built by us, which you can use to query the logs using a command line. So as shown earlier, there's a ruler component which runs in Loki, and it can talk to Prometheus for sending metrics built from logs or alerting on some conditions from the logs. Like, if you have a threshold on the errors and it exceeds the number of errors in last 15 minutes, then you can alert someone that your error rate is growing. So we'll see in a bit. So as I said, the Promptail is the agent built by us. It does the discovery of the logs, and it processes the logs and attaches some labels to it, the metadata labels that we talked about, to identify the streams. And in, it has also the capabilities to transform the logs. Yeah, like, you can rewrite some of the log lines or drop some of the contents from it, or drop the whole log line itself. And after processing the logs, it would ship the logs to Loki. On the service discovery sides, we support two types here. There's a static mode where you can run it as a binary and give it a directory where all your logs are stored, and it would start pushing the reading and pushing the logs from there. And there's another mode for running it with Kubernetes, where it would do the dynamic service discovery, same as Prometheus, and it would attach the logs, attach the labels to the logs using the Kubernetes API. So the static mode is pretty simple. In the demo, we'll cover the static mode. To talk about Kubernetes service discovery, we use the same code from Prometheus for doing the service discovery. So if you have same relabeling and service discovery config given to configured to with Promptail, then you would get same logs and same labels for your logs as the metrics from your applications. And here you can see Promptail would run as a you would have run the Promptail as daemon set on each node, and it would talk to Kubernetes API and find out which pods are running on that node, and based on your configuration, it would pull the logs from the container and ship it to attach labels based on your labeling rules, and then it would push the logs to Loki. So here you can see there are two Nginx instances running on different two nodes, and it attached the label Nginx and the IP of the node. So we support various clients. Promptail is the one which we recommend when you are running it with Kubernetes or static logs from your VMs. There's a Grafana agent which embeds Promptail, and it also, you can run Grafana agent to scrape all the metrics, logs, and traces from your Kubernetes workloads. For other environments, there's Logstash, Lambda, Fluentbit, Fluentd, and a Docker driver for various different type of scenarios where you want to scrape the logs from. So let's look at some of the features of Loki. So the most important part is the LogQL itself, which you use for querying the logs out of Loki. The LogQL language is inspired from PromQL because they have similar data model. So the most basic query is getting the logs out of Loki. Here you can see there's no metric name, which is the difference between how you do a PromQL query versus a LogQL query. So without the metric name, you just provide the labels from your for your streams. So here you are selecting app equal to foo and namespace equal to dev. And the next, we also support regex queries similar to PromQL. So here you can see it's querying for all the logs which came out of any application which has label name foo and value with anything and then bar. So we also support filter expression. So here you are using filter expression. You can filter logs based on the contents of the logs. So this answers the question asked by someone sometime back. So you select a stream and then you filter the logs based on the content. So here it would show all the logs which contain error in it, or you can chain the filters. Here you are querying for logs which contain error and also a timeout, or all the logs which contain an error without without it having keyword timeout. So we also support metric queries. So using logs, you can build metrics out of it. So there are lot many aggregation functions that we support in LogQL. These are just some examples. So the first one is the rate query, which tells you the rate at which your application is logging errors. And the second one is count over time, which counts the number of times your application has logged errors. And this is a quantile query, which you
Hi Sandeep, you're talking on mute somehow. You got probably muted yourself by accident. Yeah,
sorry.
Yes, back. Thank you so much.
Was I muted too long?
We lost you like for a couple of seconds, 10 seconds maybe.
Okay, so I'll start with metric queries. So here you can see, we support a lot many operators similar to PromQL. So here, these are just examples. And the first one is the rate query, which would show the rate at which your application is logging errors per second. And the next one is count over time, which counts the number of errors your application has logged in last 5 minutes. So this is the window at which it is sampling the logs for. And the next one is quantile over time, which you can use to see latencies, build latencies from just using your logs, which previously you were using metrics for. So if you can't if you don't have a metrics for capturing the latency, then you can use just logs to see the latency. We'll see an example of it in a bit. So there's another exciting feature called custom retention and deletion, which just got released with 2.3, and we have been running it in production for about a month, I guess. So the custom retention lets you retain logs for specific duration. Like you can even select specific retention for specific streams. Like you want to retain dev logs for just 15 days and prod logs for 3 months. Or debug logs for a month and all the error logs for a year, something like that. And all the others, after configuring the default retention, you can also configure global retention for all the remaining streams, like retain all my logs for 3 months, but just retain these streams for 15 days or something. So it's pretty flexible. And there's also deletion support that we added recently. You can delete logs for specific streams for specified duration, like delete all my logs from date 1st Jan to 31st Jan for logs sent by these applications. And we also support cancellation of unprocessed requests. Like there's a configurable duration for it, for which you can keep the delete request untouched. So if you change your mind, then you can go and cancel the request before it gets picked up for deletion. So these two features are only supported with BoltAP Shipper Index Store, which is something which we built for getting away with hosted index stores for running Loki at scale. Like previously, for running Loki at scale, you had to use DynamoDB, Bigtable, or Cassandra. But we wanted to get away with that requirement and reduce one more dependency. So there's something called BoltDB Shipper, which you can run with microservices mode, and it would use just the object store like GCS, S3, or Azure or file system itself. So you can use just the object stores for storing both chunks and index instead of a hosted index store. So one more thing, we support both these features with BoltDB Shipper Index Store because we think that's the future which we are going to move forward with. All our internal and prod clusters run with BoltDB Shipper, and it's production ready, so you can give it a try. So we also recently released recording rules and alerting support. Recording rules lets you build metrics out of your logs, so you can configure the ruler to build some metrics out of it and then forward those metrics to destination which can be Prometheus, Cortex, Thanos, or any other store which is PromQL compatible. Prometheus compatible, Prometheus API compatible. And there's another feature called alerting, which you can use to alert based on the condition of your logs. Like you can write LogQL queries and say that alert me when the error rate increases a threshold. You can also do some fancy do things like when you do a release, watch the error rate and alert me when there's some problem with the release. So you can configure an endpoint to alert manager, and it would send alerts to the alert manager. So these are the last ones are just some of the features. There are many more features, like we support replication. When we talked in the architecture, there's something called distributed hashing, using which we send logs to multiple ingesters. Like distributor is the component which does the replication, and you can configure Loki to replicate to n number of ingesters. Like we internally run with replication set to 3, so it would write the logs to 3 ingesters at a time, and if one of the ingesters goes down, you won't lose the logs. So it's a safety feature. And Loki also is also multi-tenant, so you can write logs, send logs with different tenants, store the logs with different tenant IDs. Like you can partition the logs between different teams. So like building team could use a different tenant, and your services team, booking team could use different tenant. So they won't be able to see each other's logs, and they can share the same at the same time. They can share the same Loki cluster. So there's also something called write ahead log, which is also a safety feature. When ingesters would receive logs, they would also write the logs to a disk, and if for some reason ingester is crashed, then it would the logs that it still has in memory and it has not written to the long-term object store would not be lost. It would, when the ingester comes up, it would replay the logs from the write-ahead log, and it would get the state back to what it had previously. So this avoids losing any logs if the ingester crashes before being able to write the logs to the long-term storage. We also have support for live tailing the logs, And the next one is zero dependency mode, where you can run Loki without any external dependency. So for Ring, we internally use console, like we support console, and there's something called member list. So it it keeps the state of the Ring in memory. Like, I know it's too much info. I'll just skip it for now. We can cover this in deep dive session. And for the object store, you can just run Loki with file system. And there are many more features. A lot of them are covered in the Loki docs and on the Grafana website. So let's see at a typical troubleshooting workflow that you generally go with. So there are so many tools nowadays for covering your observability stack. So first you get an alert in Slack, then you go to Grafana to see the metrics, and maybe then jump to Prometheus, and then you go to Elastic for finding the logs. Then you go to Jaeger for finding the traces, and then you go to your application for doing the code. So instead of that, we have all the three pillars for observability integrated in Grafana. So first you get an alert on Slack, then you go to Grafana. Then you can, from Grafana itself, you can jump to the, from dashboards to, you can jump directly to the metrics. And from there, you can directly jump to the logs without losing the context. From the logs, you can jump to tempo traces, and then you can go to your application for fixing the bug. We'll cover this workflow in a bit in the demo. So I have a demo running already. Like I can quickly show what is there for the demo. So I have used the latest release from Loki repo. And this is the default config that comes with Loki. So you can see it's a YAML file, and I'll explain some of the components from it, not everything. So here you can, as we talked about multi-tenancy, you can see this, there's something called auth enabled, which enables the multi-tenancy mode. And
so here, can you zoom in a bit?
Hey, Sandeep, I think just doing a control plus plus shall work.
I tried it.
Okay, that does not work. We'll have to bear with this thing. Let's get on with the demo.
Yeah, sorry.
Is there a way to increase font size from the editor, since I hope this is an editor, right?
Yeah.
I don't see.
No worries, let's go ahead.
Let's get on with the thing. Yeah, we'll see later.
Yeah, so auth enabled is something which you can toggle to enable or disable the multi-tenancy mode. This is the config for where you want to store the logs for the long-term storage. And then this is the config for configuring your long-term storage. And yeah, so there's also this ruler component where you can configure the rules and where you want to send your alerts to. And then there's this promptail config, where this is for scraping the file statically from your machine. So this is the scrape config. here you define some pipeline stages where you would tell Promptail how to process your logs. So this is a regex. We support multiple ways to process the logs. Like we support JSON format, we support CRI format, sorry, regex format. So here it tells the Promptail to pick some bits from your logs. Like the first one is the timestamp from the logs. The next one is which stream the logs are being written, which stream the logs belongs to, and then the content of the log line itself. And these properties would be shipped further to the next stage. Here we are telling Promptail to convert the stream to a label, which would be attached to your log streams. And then here we are telling it to which format the timestamp is logged in. So it's logged in RFC 3339 nano format. And the output stage would set the content of your log other than the labels. And here we are telling Promptail to find the logs. Like here, here you can configure the path where it would find the logs. So I have already started shipping logs to Loki, and we'll see in Grafana. So I already have Grafana running locally. I'll just add Loki as a data source. So you go to the data sources page, you select Loki, and then add the endpoint here. That's it, and just save. It would show you whether it was able to connect to Loki data source. Then you can go to explore and select Loki as your data source. There's something called log browser, which would show you all the labels from your streams. Here you can see the path of the file where the logs are coming from and the stream of the labels. So let's go ahead and write some queries. So I had added a job label to the stream. And so the logs that are simulated are from a file server where it would log all the requests that it's getting for uploading, downloading, or listing file. And I have added some more bits to it for showing this demo. So this is the log line. Here you can see the timestamp picked up by Promptail. And then there are some of the labels added by, like, this is the actual content of the log, and this is the timestamp from the log. So I asked Loki to give all the logs from the job file server. You can do a comma and then filter it further, like, show me only the error stream, or show me only logs which contain status code equal to 500. You can, various pipelines that we support for processing your logs, log contents. Like I have done logging in log FMT format, so you can tell Loki to convert them to log FMT format, and then all the logs, all the bits here would be converted to labels, and then you can further process it like show me logs with status code 500, or maybe you can do like duration greater than 5 seconds. So it would show all the logs which have duration greater than 500. Like, is it visible for everyone, the font?
I think increasing it a little bit would help, but to me, it's definitely visible. But I'll leave that to the rest of the audience.
Yeah, I'll keep it zoomed in a bit. You can, there are different formatters that we support. You can use JSON formatter if your logs are in JSON format, or there's something called pattern parser you can use to write the pattern in which your logs are written. Like Nginx has a different format, so you can use pattern parser to build labels out of your logs using that pattern parser. So we also support metric queries. So you can say that, show me the rate of errors from this job. So it would show the rate of, I'll select this error stream. Yeah, so it shows the rate at which your application is logging errors. Or you can build a latency graph. So you can see what is the latency of the APIs using quantile over time. So I'll show you the 99 percentile latency. So we'll convert the logs to log-fmt format because we want to use duration field from it. There's something called unwrap, which lets you convert the values from your labels to a metric. So we have a duration label. We'll convert the duration label to a duration metric. And then we'll give it a time window. We can see the latency by user. So all the users, this is showing the latency per user. You can select a specific user and see its latency. Or maybe you can just look for, you can filter it further. Like, I want to see only latency for upload calls. Yeah, there are a lot more to LogQL. We can cover more in the deep dive session. Like, this was just some basic things that you can do with LogQL. Yeah, also to show the jump that you can do between metrics and logs. So if you are having some metrics from the metrics and logs from an application, you can query the metrics. Yeah, so you look at a metrics and then you notice that there are some errors in your application. Then you can select the window where you are seeing the errors and then just change the data source to Loki, then it would show all the logs for the same time window using the same selectors. If you are having same config for your Prometheus and Promtail, then you can do the switch easily using Grafana. So moving back to the presentation. So you would say that why do we need ad hoc queries with Loki? Why not just use Prometheus? So logs is something very basic to the observability. Like everyone does the logs, not everyone uses Prometheus. And there could be a reason that you can't use Prometheus in your legacy application because it doesn't support it. So you also can convert your logs to metrics at the query time. So there are limits on the labels that you can attach to your streams both in Loki and Prometheus. So we support converting the contents from your log to metrics at the query time so that you don't explode the limit on the number of labels that you can have, like the cardinality problem. So this is the dashboard built using just Loki logs. So you can see the LogQL query language is very powerful and full of a lot of features. So you would say that with minimal log, really how fast is Loki? So these are some of the numbers from our internal Loki cluster. We have the cluster is getting 844 write QPS, and the ingestion rate is 84 MB per second or 70 Bs of log per day. And the latency is just 8 milliseconds average or 90 milliseconds P99. And we are doing 250 queries per second, and the latency there is 50 milliseconds on average and 250 milliseconds on P99. So this is in no way a benchmark for how Loki would perform. Like everyone has different setup. The usage is different, and it depends how much value you can get out of Loki based on your workflow. So to give an example, in 2020, this, like Cyril is one of the other maintainers, and he's more into improving the query performance and LogQL side of things. And he tweeted about one of the queries did 10 Gbps, like processed 10 GBs of log per second. And fast forward 1.5 years later, this was tweeted just last week. So the query did 52 GBs of logs per second. You can see the graph where the query is exceeding above 40 GBs per second, like the amount of logs that it processed per second. So how do you install and run Loki? You can install Loki using Tenka. So we have something called JSONNet, which in the Loki repo, which you can use. And the Tenka is a tool using which you can build the ML and deploy the workloads to Kubernetes. So this is a recommended method because we use it internally and it's pretty well maintained. We keep it up to date all the time. And then there's Helm, which you can use for deploying to Kubernetes. We have Docker images and a Docker Compose pre-built. And you can also use the binary for running it locally, which is what I did for doing the demo. And then you can build from the source directly. So Loki supports different modes. There's single binary mode for smaller installations, or you want to test it locally. So single binary is the preferred method. You can also run multiple single binaries, like Loki has service, different services which we saw in the architecture. There's ingester, distributor, querier. So single binary would run all those services in the same binary, same process. You can run multiple of them and make them discover each other using ring or something. And you can also run each component individually in microservices mode, like run just ingester, a set of ingesters, a set of queries, a set of query front end, and so on. And then there's Grafana Cloud free tier, which is forever free. You can ingest 50 GBs of log per month to give it a try. And then you can continue using it if you are well within the limit, or you can upgrade to a paid tier. It also comes with Prometheus series. So you can do 10,000 series with Prometheus with free tier. So this is the case study which we did with Paytm Insider. So I met with Piyush at DevOps Days India 2019 when we did the talk there. So he mentioned about how they switched from Elastic to Loki, and we did a case study with them. So as you can see, they saved a lot of cost on, and they saved a lot of cost that they were paying for managing an Elastic cluster. They claimed that they reduced the cost was reduced by 75% when switched from Elastic to Loki, and their MTTR reduced from 30 minutes to just 10 minutes. So that's it from my side. If anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Hey, thanks for the great talk, Sandeep, and thanks for an extended demo session. Normally, we finish demos in a very short period, and thanks for an extended and in-depth demo. So we'll be taking up questions. I think we have a couple of them. I think I will just let Satya ask his question and then see if you can answer that, because we had sort of stopped it there in the middle of the talk. So Satya, can you just unmute yourself and go ask the question?
I think the answer, the question is answered, but just to recap, I was wondering, for the content that is not indexed, how does Loki grab it, and what would be the, I don't know if efficiency is the right word for it. So what is the speed difference, if you say, if it's a label based or if it's been tagged as a label, obviously it's going to be like in almost instant. How would that compare versus something which is, hidden deep inside, and assuming that you're doing terabytes of logs per day?
Yeah, so as I said, it depends on the workflow that you have. So if you have a lot of streams that keep, if you have a lot of stream churn, then Loki would not perform well, because maybe it would be because of the kind of labels that you are attaching it with. Like if you are attaching labels called user ID, or if you have an ordering application and you are attaching the order ID to it, then it's not something that is recommended. The labels model is similar to Prometheus, where you won't attach order ID or something to your metrics. So as far as the content is concerned, we store the logs in something called chunks, and that is what your index points to. When you do the query, we would fetch the chunks from the storage and then decompress the logs from it and then go through it. So if your chunks are really full, then it should not have a problem. Like it can go through the chunks. Like imagine you have a million chunks for a query, and versus a million 100 chunks which are full. A million chunks 10% full, or 100 chunks completely full. So that is the difference that makes the kind of labels. So if you have labels which are the value is not bounded, then it would create a lot of tiny chunks, and then query would suffer because it has to get a lot of chunks from the storage, versus if you have a bounded index, then it would just process through the logs while going through it. You can build metrics from it on the at the query time. So it's not like, oh, I missed adding this label. I really wanted to add the order ID label to it. Then you don't have to worry because there's query time metrics available, as I showed.
I have a related question. Then basically, to leverage the architecture of Loki, we will need to have the level selectors as metadata and not inside the payload JSON of the log line itself, because you are not indexing that. If we have a structured JSON log and let's say the level value pairs are hidden deep inside that structure somewhere, that wouldn't really help. We'll need to extract that and basically,
oh, no.
You change the log implementation a bit then?
So you can every time tell Loki that these are JSON logs. Okay. And then use the contents from your JSON logs as labels in next.
Oh. So only then the message part of the log will not be indexed. Every other key value pair will then be converted to level then.
Yeah, so just tell it to treat those logs as JSON, and then all the contents, like if you have JSON and inside that there's a bit called foo equal to bar, then the foo would be able at query time. And no, then
so
you can use
my question is that how does Loki know which part is contained? And how, so we have, let's say, multiple JSON key value pairs. Let's think of it as a single hierarchy JSON where there are just a map of key value pairs, right? So how does Loki know which part is the contained or not to be indexed and which parts are the labels which needs to be indexed? Do we explicitly tell that to Loki during consumption, during prompt and configuration?
No, not during consumption. The content is just a text for Loki. And you at query time, you tell it what the text is.
Okay. Also, I did define the schema during the runtime itself, not...
Okay. Yeah, you just tell it how to make sense out of it. Like if your logs are in log FMT format, you tell it that these are log FMT. Okay. Or your logs are in JSON format. So the content of your logs are just text. And the labels are key value pairs and there's timestamp. So these are the three parts to your logs that are stored in Loki.
Yeah, we'll go to Piyush Asher's question. I think Piyush, can you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Yeah, I think it got answered during the course of the talk, but like when the talk started, I was just wondering, like, is the label detection, it has some predefined tools on which it detects, or it's something that has to be manually configured? But based on the talk, what's coming across is that, to give a very, it could be a bad analogy, right? When I'm creating my log appender format and I'm defining the structure, it's essentially a similar way I can define structure on the Promtail YAML file, like which are the columns you want to index, and accordingly it will return the queries essentially.
Right.
So labels is just a metadata. The metadata could be the name of the app. Then, like in Kubernetes, there would be namespace, the
node ID, container ID, all of that. Right?
Yeah,
node
yeah, ID. Yeah. Right. So you can also, like, Promtail also support building the labels at processing time. Like based on your logs, you can attach new labels to it. So that is also pretty powerful when configuring your labels.
Got it.
And the content is just text. It can be anything. It could be JSON. It could be just random text or a log FMT or anything.
Cool. I think that concludes our first talk. Thank you so much, Sandy, for, a really great talk. While it was supposed to be an intro, I think we were borderline deep dive, and I am excited to hear from you what the actual deep dive content actually will be there. And I think most of us here would appreciate the deep dive talk. We are looking forward to it. That's it. I think we'll take a short break. But before we do that, I just want to ask from the audience that, does anyone want to do like a very short flash talk regarding the stuff they are doing at their workplace? I see Manoj is here, Satya is here, Piyush is here. So we have a lot of great people who are in leadership positions in their respective organizations in here. So if someone would like to talk about, observability in their respective organizations, or if someone is new and just started with observability and they just want to highlight even something simple that they have been doing, you know, that will really be great. If not, after the break session, you know, we will into this meetup because we do not have a second speaker around. So we have like 10 minutes of break. If you feel like, if anyone does feel like doing a flash talk, please let me know in the chat or DM me on the Telegram group if you are over there, and we'll make a space for you to, you know, do your talk as quickly. There need not be any presentation. There need not be any PPT. That's not the format of flash talks. You could open up like an online whiteboard and just draw stuff out in case you need to explain anything diagrammatically. So yeah, I think with that, we'll take a short break and come back in 5 minutes to see if anyone is doing a talk. If not, we will skip over to the banter session, which we always do. Some of us always like to catch up after the main session is over, and we just talk about all sort of tech that we are doing, not limited to just observability. And that will be today's meetup, folks. Thank you so much for joining us. So we'll take a short break and come back. Hi, Navarun, Satya, Piyush, thanks for joining us today. Long time. What's been up? We can see a normal catch-up session, I guess. And for the people who are joining us for the first time, a short introduction would be super nice. And Manoj, hi, how are you doing? Thanks for joining us.
Hey, Joy. Thanks for the welcome. I know I missed the first 30 minutes of the meeting, but good to get onto this forum.
No worries. Both the PPTs and, you know, the videos would be properly edited and uploaded by the Haskell team.
Sure.
And you'll be able to catch up. Yeah. I was actually looking forward to hearing from you regarding the talk regarding, you know, observability and UX. So let me know.
I initially kept quiet because I didn't have anything to talk, because a lot of brainstorming going at this point of time. If you can see my question to Sandeep, in fact, I had a demo with the Lockie folks from Grafana a couple of weeks ago. Me, I think Roland also on this call, I think. We work together. So
awesome.
Flipkart. So we had a demo with the Lockie folks, I think a couple of weeks ago. And I think they were frank enough to say that, like, you know, hey, high cardinality is a challenge, right? And yeah, I think I kind of kicked off this UX discussion. I thought, okay, I'll probably come here and I'm going to hear the perspective of people here when it comes to what is UX to them. So I know each of you support your respective organization in varying, you know, capacity. And I think UX is a challenge. Maybe I'll also turn on my video so that we can have a face to. So, you know, what is UX to you, right? So I just asked this question, like, you know, hey, in your implementation, how do you use Loki for? Is it for debugging purpose? Is it for detecting issues?
I don't use Loki at my current workplace. I have been a person for a very long time. But when it comes to UX of all the observability tools taken, if we take it as a blanket sort of group, while that is definitely not true, one of the like comparisons I can try and make is that, let's say, any of the proprietary implementations, like, you know, let's talk Datadog, New Relic, versus something like Grafana. What matters to me is in the UX of these things is not just how beautiful the dashboard sort of look after I have done configuring things, but what is the workflow of getting it run, like getting it bootstrapped, and what is the process of getting a bare minimum dashboard up and running? How many hoops I have to go through, right? How many steps do I have to configure? How much of it is sort of auto-detecting, and how much of it is intuitive for me? And one of the good tests, I think, is that if you ask a new person who is probably new to DevOps or in the observability ecosystem as a whole, how quickly does that person adopt to this technology? Like, if you ask them to configure a New Relic dashboard versus a Grafana dashboard, what is the entry barrier there? How easy do they find it to get things up and running? That is, I think, a test of good UX when it comes to observability tools. Because if you have a tool where you're making dashboards and you have to go often enough, go back, look into the documentation, look at screenshots in the documentation, then come back and then figure out that, okay, hey, now this is the right way to do things. That, I think, hinders anyone's workflow, right? The UI itself should have enough content, tooltips, links to docs, or you know, helpful ways of helpfully arranged workflows, which lets a person sort of figure things out as they go with iterations, rather than frequently going back to documentation, reading up, and then figuring out. So to me, that's like sort of probably a benchmark of how good an UX is for any particular tool in this ecosystem at least.
Okay, I think that is that probably covers like one part of it, right? Basically, how do you onboard?
Yeah.
Right, how do you onboard, and what is a frictionless onboarding, and how do you get a basic out of the box observability without having to worry about a lot, right? So that also brings to the point that, hey, how do we create an opinionated observability for the organization, especially the kind of organization stack we you know, use to build services and application. Yeah, I think definitely I concur with you. I think that's one of the mindset shift we're trying to you know, bring even in Flipkart. Just to give an example, you know, there are so many metrics, and typically I'm sure this is something everyone faces in the organization. I don't know what percentage of metrics collected or ingested into your system is being used. Right, I think I really like, you know, ask each of you to kind of do some kind of soul searching and say, hey, is it 80-20 or it is like, you know, maybe even more skewed, right? So that opinionated observability is something, you know, is the theme which I'm trying to push these days, you know, in Flipkart, that, you know, the vitals are few, and you know, that there are many trivial things which we go chase, and that kind of, you know, kill your be it your metric system, be it a logging system, to kind of, you know, solve all sort of thing. And so the user experience often can be like in a very purpose driven than trying to solve everything in the world, right? So we have some we have a metric system internally which kind of solves for very simple, straightforward, you know, high-level metrics and cardinality challenges to ultra cardinality, hyper cardinality problems in a single system, and it, you know, and that kind of use that kind of kills all kind of user experience, right? So that basically talks about, okay, what is the at the time of using your observability tool, what is experience for various you know, users, right? Onboarding you talked about, but then as you come to this. Come to the application or the observability tool you're using. And there are different use cases for different set of users. Some come there to just to detect an issue. Some even look at your monitoring system or metric system as a troubleshooting or a debugging mechanism. For that, they kind of start keep on adding a lot of tags or dimensions, which basically leads you to that eventual you know, hyper-cardinality state and then all kind of problem, right? So that's why I asked this question to Sandeep. Yeah, Sandeep, what is the use case, or what is the primary objective of having your Loki in your organization? Is it for detecting issues? Is it for debugging something? Because viewing logs, I agree, viewing logs is for a purpose.
Yeah.
Right. Typically, it is for detecting something or debugging something, or you are trying to figure out a particular transaction which someone said, hey, this transaction. You are from Paytm, Sandeep?
No, I am from Grafana.
I'm a Grafana. Okay, good. So there should be some, hey, this particular transaction, I want to search. I'll give a typical example of Flipkart, right? So we have a, you know, you can say, hey, someone comes and build a cart in Flipkart, and then they check out, and then the packet comes to you maybe like after 2 or 3 days, depending upon okay, where you are and or where the system, where the item is coming. And then maybe like, you know, you use it for a day and then return it and comes all the way back to our warehouse, right? Then kind of, okay, let's say a transaction is running for like, you know, maybe weeks altogether, right? Or maybe multiple weeks before it can complete. So for us, a lot of our problems are like, you know, debugging. So when you look at Loki and logs or any kind of, look at, of course, throughput and all that comes into one side, but tracing through what happened to, you know, individual transactions, which is running across multiple days, or maybe like, you know, things becomes one of the you know, key thing, and you know, that is one of the user experience they're looking for. Hey, can I trace everything about that particular okay transaction which probably happened okay across multiple you know weeks?
So if you log some ID with it, like order ID or something, then you can use the filter to search over the logs using that order ID, using the logs filter.
I mean, you need a unit. If you consider this Manoj and workflow, then you need a workflow ID across the for everything in the lifecycle of a cart that actually happens. Like, what is the order ID, the payment ID, the shipment ID, whatever, return ID. There could be like 15 different intermediary workflows, right? But you need to probably like group them together. Like, inside an application, we do this with request ID, right? For tracing purposes.
Exactly.
By doing
exactly.
Or something.
Yeah.
Similarly, you need to. I think we need to wrap the whole workflow inside a single UUID and then somehow get that everywhere, right?
Right. So we have to, if you do sampling, then we kind of, a typical tracing, it doesn't work there.
Yeah.
And an order ID is a, for a company like Flipkart, I think it's a high cardinality value, right? So,
So I think my demo didn't make it much clear. Like, I can share the screen again and show you some more.
I think last time we had a demo of this, like with exemplars, where you could literally take like one ID from Tempo Trace and to see the correlated logs on Loki with that particular trace ID, right?
Is it okay to share my screen again?
Hey, Roland, you could, at this point, I think everyone can unmute themselves. I will consider that we have crossed over into a semi-banter, semi-flash talk station. So people can unmute and you can just ask the question. You can turn on the video if you feel like. So feel free to just be yourself right now. We are live, but since we're talking about a concrete topic, we are all good.
Yeah. So, so my logs doesn't contain, like, the logs that I simulated doesn't contain a label called user ID in it. This is just content of the log. The user ID is in the content of the log, not attached to the stream as a label. So I can build a label out of it at query time because you don't want to set it as a label in the streams. Like in Prometheus, you won't use the user label, otherwise it would explode the cardinality. So these are, the logs are in log_fmt format. So I'll tell Loki that this is a log_fmt format. So whatever is there in this would be converted into a label at query time. And then I would, I can use those labels at query time for further processing. Like if I want to do rate latency for each user, like I want to see what latency is for per user. So I'll do,
Can you do this like an NTP ID kind of a query, which kind of scenario we just talked about, where an NTP ID you can kind of pick up on the query time and can kind of stitch everything together. I don't know, their demo application kind of has that level of.
Yeah, that could be a bit hard because
you can do the ID, like the user is another text for it, text for Loki, the transaction ID or whatever. Would be another text for Loki. So it would just convert it into a label if it's in like in log_fmt, there would be another bit here called transaction ID equal to something. So you can use transaction ID here. As a label, it would convert that into a label at query time.
So what does it mean to convert this into query time, and what is the cost for a maybe multi-terabyte or multi-petabyte kind of,
I was just going to that. Like, if you have like 15 million transactions at that sort of a scale, what's the cost of retrieving all those chunks and then sort of filtering out the transaction IDs and then indexing them good enough way so that you're able to search and plot it, right?
So either you pay the cost for managing that big index, or either you throw that much power to queriers and then they should be able to process it. So it's not like you would use all the transaction IDs and query it, like all the transaction IDs that your application is logging or all the user IDs that your application is logging. You would look at specific logs in specific window and then just throw enough processing power and it should be able to do it.
Yeah, it's not a freelance, I think, absolutely.
But it's still a challenging problem, because then you need to basically be aware of your ingestion rate and your transaction rate in order to right size your cluster. Because at any point of time, any arbitrary query which goes beyond the capability of the cluster to handle chunk sizes, let's say I have enough compute to do 30-day window of transaction ID plots.
Mm.
But the moment if someone comes in and does like a 45-day window, my cluster is open for a toss, right? Because the compute is not there, enough compute is not there anymore. So that could be a literal problem, because like feels like this, the size is very arbitrary. I'm pretty sure for Manoj, so you have data seasonality, right? Sometimes,
I think this will work for a short window of time. For example, I have like a 1 hour of, you know, say maybe order would have been a wrong example I took, because that can run into like multiple days, and then you kind of forget, you know, searching through the entire, haystack to get the needle, right? I don't think it is a bad idea. But if the same thing is for like, you know, I'm looking for something happening like in a live exam, like a sale day of Flipkart, like, you know, last 3-2 hours, maybe still reasonable, the thing to kind of search for this. That's why I'm talking about, don't try to make your system to solve all use cases, right? So you need to kind of see how can we create that tiers of, okay, you know, focused problem solving into this part. So,
I think like the long-term storage and search problems and fast search of logs in a definite amount of time, in a constrained amount of time, I think they're very separate use cases, and the architecture needed to build that is very different. Like if I want to search like millions of transaction IDs, I would rather put that in like a long-term storage store in a sort of a big data sort of ecosystem, big table or something. And I'll use stuff like AWS Athena or something to query that at a later point of time, not strain my life log systems.
Exactly. In that case, we don't need, the latency is not a big issue, right? I can say, get me this data after, say, 2 minutes, or, you know, that's fine with me. So that's what, so from user experience point of view, when you ingest a log, right, I think really, you know, one of the, you know, thought processes other we kind of, you know, working on is how do we segregate, right? So that you tier this, you know, log and tier, you know, how many different type of storage you need so that we can, probably like, you know, we're mostly going to define that by the retention period or something like that, so that, you know, the latency can be coupled with it for different use cases. So something which you really need, again, immediately a partition. I think Loki is a partition optimized solution, right? You basically partition the storage by a time window, and then it works very well there. But talking about a clustering of data where you have to do a huge indexation.
I think I'll pause both of you for a moment and go to Roland once. Roland, you had something to say on the chat. You can just unmute yourself and just let's have the conversation.
Yeah, nothing more, not much more on top of that. As Manoj said, I work with him. I've been part of Flipkart doing building and operating this for about 3 odd years now. And our lessons have been what Manoj articulated, right? It's primarily around scale and I would say a interesting mix of use cases that that spans across real-time debug to historical debug to archival search. And as Manoj was saying, it is probably not a good idea to solve all of them in one system.
So I will take the same concept and I'll go to the rest of the folks who are here. We have Piyush, we have Satya. How do we sort of, do you maintain separate stacks for RCA, which is live debugging, and have separate stuff for cold storage searches where you are searching for, let's say, a couple of months periods of data to go back in time and search for stuff? How do you handle that in your particular organizations?
See, in our case, what we run is for real-time debugging. So we have the ELK kind of a stack running where logs have up to 3 days are indexed on a SSD backed storage running Elasticsearch on top, right? And anything older than that, the logs are anyways getting piped into an S3 bucket. Over there, what we do is on the S3 bucket, the agent which pushes the logs in the S3 bucket, we have defined our own partitioning scheme, which allows us to define the subpaths on the S3 bucket. And then the support team which needs to access these logs which are older than 3 days, 4 days to answer some customer queries, they use S3 Select or Athena on top of it, like just like what Joy you mentioning. So S3 Select has been working for us, and I mean, like even for like about 250-300 gig of log search, it takes hardly a couple of minutes to respond back. I think that's where you're. So basically, Manoj, to your point, basically the joining of the logs and all, something which keeps happening in the background. That's not something we need in real time anyways. So real time, like in Elasticsearch, ELK stack, or in this case, Loki can probably help, right? But if you want to join and you want to analyze data over a longer period of time, you'll have to anyways store it outside. So, yeah.
Yeah, so one of the things about working for a big company is that you have nice platform teams. So we have a team which runs our logging system, which is basically Splunk. So I don't have to care about, so Splunk does some intelligent swapping around between hot and cold archives. That's configurable. I think the default is like 7 days or 14 days. It was revised recently, I don't know. And to me, honestly, I don't care, because all I do is, I go to Splunk, I put in my query, and then I start diving deep. Splunk handles it intelligently behind the scenes. It will shuttle the data between hot and cold storage, and it presents me the data. And my use case is, either ways, for real-time debugging. For me, there's a question about the UX. For me, what I want from my observability team is, from my observability experiences, when I'm woken up at 3 a.m., I don't want to fiddle and change the settings and try to. What I want is, I want to, have start with a base query and start a good deep diving in. And that's where my biggest problem has been with Grafana, primarily because of lack of experience with Grafana. I'm getting better. I open Grafana, I want to look at the metrics, and I go blank. It's like I can't get the prompt queue allowed because it's 3 a.m. in the morning. Of course, things have changed now. Like, I have ready-made links. We have runbooks with all those things. These sort of help. But,
we should register
an account from QL at 3 a.m. Yeah, that's not going to work. I'm sorry. From QL at 3 a.m. Let me honestly tell you, my prompt QL experience at 3 a.m. is like, try to come up with something and then utterly give up. And then and then what I do is, I'm like, screw this shit. I just type node. That's it. Node one. So that basically gives me the load of every node. And then from there, I know what labels are there. And then I start using that to deep dive. But that's, that's like a long-winded approach.
I think this is a fair point on the UX side of things. How easy it is to query in a language if you are either sleepy or drunk.
Right? Manasif Splunk spoils one. I completely agree. Once you start using Splunk, right, to get started with Splunk, you're like, what the heck is this? SQL, they have their own query language, Splunk query.
Yeah. Question to you. So, a couple of things. So, where do you work?
I work at Adobe.
Adobe, okay, nice. So, I don't know how much budget, I don't want to ask a question, how much budget you guys have, you want to Splunk? Because I worked in a company where, Splunk can literally eat up your entire AWS budget. We are in AWS, so budget in no time. And developers just don't control what they ingest, right? So Splunk is such a thing which spoils people. And that gives you like a one place you cannot do everything. That's experience Splunk gives, right? I have a question, Goyal. So you talked about you have a Elastic ELK stack for your 3 days retentions, yeah, data and other, right? So do you ever come into this the problem of people comparing about, I need a one place, one stop shop kind of a thing where I want to go at one place, and yeah, does it matter if you get it from ELK or
No, it has happened, Manoj, but in our case, what happens is, when you're accessing a log, right, people already know that they need to query any recent event, or they're looking for an archival instance essentially. Right, so we are talking only about two dashboards, two UIs. Right, so just by looking at the query or the support ticket or maybe even the incident that comes from the NOC team, right, you know whether I need to look at my recent last 1 hour logs, which are available on the ELK dashboard, right? And if it's a query coming to a customer support team and the queries are like 5 days older, you always know that there's a UI we have given on top of SC Select. So it's fairly convenient in that sense. You know.
Okay. I think 3 days is a pretty decent window you're providing, right?
Yeah.
Almost for
actually, again, I think AWS has this Elastic File System EFS, right? So that allows us to keep expanding and contracting the storage we need. So we don't need to forecast that, you know, that my 3 day log storage will be about 30 terabyte, 40 terabyte, whatever it is. EFS allows you to expand and contract at runtime, essentially. So
I think like 7 days is also like 7 working days is a good enough window to keep for me to, you know, moderately large startups. Definitely not an enterprise scale. 7 days would be very large enterprise.
Correct. Like, see, nowadays, even we arrived at a 3 day window after, you know, after a hit and trial of almost 7 to 8 months. So then we realized this gives a sweet spot of, you know, having a low MTTR in terms of responding to the tickets as well as ensuring our storage and indexing costs are not going very, very high. So,
yeah. I think
any resistance you faced, during that time when you kind of, you know, came to this 3 days, developers or your consumers or this block?
No, obviously, I mean, see, S3 Select takes about a couple of minutes to scan like 100, 200 gigs of data, right? Initially, whenever you try to have this kind of new system coming in, there is always an inertia. The developer used to complain and all that. Then the way I did it is that, you know, we started exposing the cost of the logging clusters to the respective teams. Right, you told them either you reduce it or you tell me what you want to do, right? And after a few days, everybody goes back, yeah, it's okay, we can manage this. Anyway, we have to just query 3-4 times a day. So like 5-10 minutes extra, we are okay to wait. Right. So yeah, I've seen one of the sessions, it's all about visibility. You go and tell developers how much is cost, what is the effort to maintain all of this infrastructure. And then they start cooperating, essentially.
Yeah, but because typically one of the most important view I see in developers looking for is that, hey, I see a spike now, but can I zoom back or go back to like a last week this time or like a last month? Is there seasonality in this spike, right? So that is where right. This 3 day kind of a cutoff really kills you.
Right.
You guys, the way you guys are talking, I'm really scared when I move out of Adobe because you guys are talking about retrieval in minutes. For me, it takes less than a second to find anything. And we do over, I'm pretty sure, I don't know the exact volume, but it's over 100 terabytes a day of logs. So I'm like, now I'm like really wondering, okay, I've been spoiled by Splunk so much.
Yes, you are.
You guys are literally talking about, you know, 3 minutes, 5 minutes. I'm like, really? It takes me less than a second to get
So that's like 3 minute, 5 minute is mostly on the like the cold side of things. Can Splunk do cold search also within like a couple of seconds?
I don't, like I said, you know, I can find, like the hot one will be less than a second. The cold ones will probably be like less than 30 seconds, I guess.
Can you get one of your platform team members next time so that they can talk about this, like how they're we'll all be super, super interested to hear out, right? I have done Splunk very briefly at Razorpay and then we properly moved out to, you know, Prometheus. I think Satya used to come by at that point of time. I mean, it has not been super difficult, like a couple of seconds of window, 2 minute, 2 second, 3 second latency for even a real-time search is okay. But the week-on-week analysis is something that I saw on Prometheus, not on logging side, of course, but metrics side I have seen. We solved that with Thanos, where Grafana would be a single interface for both live Prometheus and then Thanos separately. And then we can basically overlay both the graphs together, at least for the metric analysis part. And at Hotstar, like, one of the critical things was we did historical analysis of our metrics and scaled based on that. So live Prometheus was one of the metrics based on which our entire Kubernetes cluster sort of scaled up and down. And we also did the scale testing by applying the historical data, replaying the historical sort of APIs for in the scale test environment. And that sort of helped. But yeah, with logs, it's sort of difficult. Right now I'm on Datadog and I'm really thankful that I can very easily do week on week analysis, at least going back 3 weeks. I know it's containing a lot of data, but this is good enough a benchmark.
That's the other thing. Once you get started with DataRog, right, it's so before we moved to Prometheus and Grafana, we were on DataRog. I used DataRog before Adobe. I was using it StyleTech. I moved to Adobe. I saw that they were using DataRog. I was very happy. DataRog made our life so much easier, like especially with the tagging system that they had. Now just tag your infra and DataRog will automatically pick it, apply it as labels, create a dash. Create a dashboard of literally, you know, seconds sort of thing. And then we jumped from there to, you know, to Prometheus. And at that point, we didn't have any dashboards on. And that's where I said, you know, the whole PromQL thing, like.
I think it's just the difference between, see, like a managed service costs higher, the engineering cost is low. On the other side, like for open source platform, like Grafana, Prometheus, your engineering cost is much higher. But your platform costs, since it's self-maintained, it's super, super low. So like, again, I think this also is UX, but this is more towards like, what is more important to the organization, right? Do you want to build an internal team and maintain like a platform team, which maintains like low latency Prometheus Grafana servers that scales instantly, operates instantly, or do you want to assign that cost to an external platform and then just like, you know, go ahead and get everything done, reduce engineering costs. So
yeah, but when you have when you're in an organization the size of Adobe where you have literally thousands of teams, right? It's dead by 1,000 paper cuts, right? You must be the engineering time per team might be minuscule, but you know it adds up. Of course, there's definitely no doubt. I'm pretty sure that's the reason. The cost was the reason why we moved out of DataRog. I don't have any insight into it. You know, and I'm not really. Saying that I regret moving to Prometheus and Grafana, like as I've started using it more and more, like I've completely built out the dashboards now. You know, we used to do, and probably talk about this next time around in the next week, but we used to do log-based querying and looking at, you know, how our deploys are going, things like that. And now instead of, you know, having to run Splunk search every 10 seconds, every 1 minute, I just have Grafana dashboard on one of my monitors with auto refresh, and since we do you know rolling rather we do A/B deploys, it's so nice to see the graphs being crisscrossing. I'll add a screenshot. It's like, you know, the way one graph goes down and the other graph comes up. We have it it's just so nice to see. I'm getting used to it, but those initial first 3 to 6 months when we're struggling to cope up with PromQL, because moving away from DataRog and to learning PromQL was not the only thing. We had, you know, as with any org, there'd be lots of other competing priorities. So you're like, do I spend my time in improving my knowledge in helping, you know, so that we can resolve our incidents faster? Where do I find the time to improve our existing sub tech debt, our feature requests that are coming? So that was a tough thing to manage. And we had a very, very low time. I think basically it was told us in 6 months we're out of DataDog, and that's final. And you know, it's like either walk the plank or jump out, sort of like that.
Yeah, I mean, these are very tough business decisions to make. There are a lot of variables roaming around, like engineering cost, or cost, time to deliver, time to get it bootstrapped, all of that. So yeah, as Piyush says, right, it's all about priorities, right?
Yeah.
Cool. I think that is a good conversation. So we have Navarone and Sudhir with us. Would you folks like to contribute anything here? Shall we move on?
Are you able to hear me?
Yeah. Hey, Sudhir, we can hear you. Hi, how are you doing?
Hey, okay. Yeah, good. Thanks for asking. It's been a good, interesting conversation, right? Okay, I take care of observability at Freshworks.
Oh,
I'm just a lurker trying to learn what's happening around and all that. And this has been my third meetup, so learning quite a few things, right? It's okay. So, yeah, we have our internal system. We are based on Elasticsearch, and we do pretty heavy traffic, right? Somewhere around 40 TB per day on the logs cluster, right? That's how it is. And when you're using Elasticsearch, and we only use Elasticsearch, right? There's nothing on S3 and all that.
So like hot and cold purposes are served by Elasticsearch itself? What's your retention period like?
So we have a retention of 30 days.
Okay.
So the data on disk is in a couple of petabytes, right? Mm-hmm. And we have our own hot warm architecture on Elasticsearch. That's how we're able to live up to the SLAs requirements of multiple products within Freshworks, right?
Right. So you're like on proprietary Elasticsearch platform, basically, in that case.
Yeah.
That makes sense. So
hosted, right?
Yeah. So I think that's like coming up as a thing, right? Like if you want hyperscale low latency scenarios, internal platform teams sort of break at a certain threshold of maintenance levels, right? Where the cost of maintenance is higher than, you know, like the profit that you're getting out of it. And at that point, you have to go for an enterprise level solution, I guess. So, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, at least with the traffic that we are handling, we are maintaining everything internally.
Okay. When can we hear a talk from you, Sudhir? Maybe next time around. Would be glad.
Yeah, sure. I've been planning for it.
Sure. You have a month going ahead. So, yeah, let's plan for that together. Like, join the Telegram group. And that's for everyone watching also. So, we have a Telegram group. The link is in the descriptions, I guess. And if not, we will ensure that the description is there. Or the YouTube link has the link to the HasGeek meetup. And there, the Telegram link is already there. So it's two hops. But of course, like if you're interested, you can manage that. So yeah, if folks who are watching there, if you're interested, please join the Telegram group and we can continue this conversation over chat. And thanks everyone for joining us on a Saturday morning. Thanks, Sandeep, for making the time. And I know all of you have had a hard week and glad that you were turned up on a Saturday. And thanks, Manoj, Satya, Piyush. All of you have been regulars here. And thanks, Navarun, for dropping by. We just said hi yesterday and thanks for dropping by here. Glad that we could have you. So, yeah, with that, let's wrap up.